Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to welcome all of you gathered in this online platform, all connected today with us for the second online public session organized by Mechanical Engineering Section Committee of Institute of Engineers Sri Lanka. Today, the session is about air conditioning best practices for Sri Lanka's infection control. In Sri Lanka, air conditioning spaces are observed to be dangerously substandard. In many locations, air conditioning has been done using split type air conditioning systems, which have no provisions for air changes. So today, during this lecture, safe and effective practices that can be adopted by Sri Lankan engineers will be discussed in detail to mitigate airborne viruses such as COVID-19, which could be circulating inside buildings. So today's before starting the lecture. Presentation today, few house rules. Please keep your microphones muted. Please keep your microphones muted. Today's session would be held as two sessions. First, the presentation, and then the question and answer session. The question and answering session, as we called it, the Q&A session would be conducted by Engineer Ganesh Dahanayake, who is a member of Mechanical Engineering Sectional Committee. And the first part is the presentation. To conduct the presentation today, we have Engineer Nissanka Serasinghe connected with us today. Engineer Nissanka Serasinghe, subsequent to engineering faculty, University of Ceylon education in 1966, Engineer Nissanka commenced his practice at the British-owned multidisciplinary engineering company, Vokas. He progressed progressively raised to be its general manager, works and marine engineering division. From 1988, Engineer Nissanka served in the directorate of Samuels, Vokas and DSI Samson Group, where engineering infrastructures were modernized. At the age of 76, is still in an active engineer, and his advice is sought by insurance loss adjusters and risk assessors when they encounter serious engineering shortcomings causing health and safety problems, especially in air conditioning systems and plant damages. So without further ado, I would like to hand over controls to our presenter today, Engineer Nissanka. Over to you, Engineer Nissanka.
Thank you, Engineer Amarasurya, for the introduction and the initial description of the subject. I am highly honored that the IESL has invited me to make this presentation. I am highly honored. Before I start, I will greet all of you in the traditional way, Ayubovan, because it has two ideas. One is the traditional single way of greeting. The second one is today's talk will be based on health. That is air conditioning systems to see that you are healthy and you will live long. So that's why greeting Ayubovan to be important. Actually, I came across an Indian Army document. Indian services of the Indian Army. Although I found it, I am not in the Sri Lankan Secret Service to get Indian Army. This document was initiated by the Indian Army Engineer Services after they saw the guidelines given by the Indian Society of Air Conditioning, Indian Society of Refrigeration, Heating and Air Conditioning Engineering. It's called ISRAE. You get a similar organization in America called ASHRAE. I think the Sri Lankan branch of AC engineers, I think a section of the American one, ASHRAE. These are engineers, practicing engineers who see to it that the engineering, the air conditioning is done to accepted standards. In Sri Lanka also, this organization is there, but maybe due to other external factors, our air conditioning seems to be very much in a poor state. The general concept of understanding about air conditioning is cooling. People, anyone would say that that place is fine, it's very cool, but that's not air conditioning. Air conditioning has to have fresh air, correct humidity, it should be draft free, and the airflow regimes should be satisfactory with adequate air changes. If these are not there, the air conditioning system is not good. After me, there will be two other resource persons, an architect, a chartered architect, and a doctor, medical practitioner, who are interested in this area, this field of this topic of air conditioning, who will also make contributions from their angles. Now, I told you that there are standards issued by ASHRAE, and in India, ISRAE. I don't know, I have not heard of any of these regulations enforced in Sri Lanka. There are also in the States an organization called OSHA, that is Occupational Safety Health Association. They also give guidelines for air conditioning, that they should be not harmful to humans. Then WHO and some other organizations also have issued guidelines and circulars from time to time. You can see them in the internet. I went through the internet quite a lot when I was asked to make this video, this talk. The architect who will speak later will tell you the air conditioning standards of different places will be different, has to be different. For example, in office it will be one, a school it's another one, a restaurant another one, and the worst place is autopsy rooms where they do cut the dead bodies. There you can't have air conditioning, really no recirculation. You have to get fresh air to come in, and the entire air lot is sent out. You don't recirculate. That's the worst scenario. So now, normally the air condition place, you have to specify the humidity, temperature, drafts, flow regimes, and air changes. This should be discussed by the other contributors, the doctor and the architect. I must tell you that the Sri Lankan airspaces are very dangerous, because they are 99% fitted with split type AC units. I think you know what split type units are. The cartoon which was at the start of the show showed the thing. They are normally fitted high up on the wall. And there are two tubes going out of the wall. So many people think that those two tubes are carrying fresh air in and out. Those two tubes only carry refrigerant, not fresh air. And air conditioned spaces with that type of air conditioner, there's no fresh air at all. So actually ASHRAE doesn't encourage them. These are mainly used in Asian countries and Indonesia and this. South Asian countries, if you are fixing a split type air conditioner, you have to have a fair amount of fresh air coming in. That is not suitable for a place which is kept closed all the time and a lot of people working inside. I will come to it later. It's very dangerous. Then this other type is central air conditioning, which you find in big places, in cinema halls. You see them in hotels, five-star hotels, Bank of Ceylon Tower building. Huge places, they have central air conditioning. They have the machinery out and they send in cold air, cooled, conditioned air, cooled, filtered air with a percentage of fresh air. There is a controlling system where fresh air is admitted and foul air is sent out. You can't have 100% like for autopsy room because then the energy requirement is very high. So there has to be a recirculation for economy. But with recirculation, you are not, it's nothing like having fresh air. You know, you are using the old air all the time. Now, the split units, I have come across very dangerous places, disgusting places. One place I can mention is the ID card issuing office in Bartharamul. About 500 people are inside there, and they have to wait for hours and hours. Although this say same day service, the ID cards are given 7-8 hours later. So some people who have come from faraway places, they have to live inside there. And it's a terrible place. Then you get RMV office and so many places, hotels. There are small cafeterias, thin, long ones with the split unit at the far end. I have come across very dangerous places. Even central air conditioning, although I mentioned that fresh air inlet and outlet is there. I'll give you an example where the five-star hotel, because the operator couldn't switch on the AC in time, he started coming in, he shut the fresh air inlet and the outlet and ran its recirculation. Started at 7, at 10 p.m., with the big crowd coming inside and the barbecue flames, the temperature, the carbon dioxide level rose to 2000 ppm. Normally in the outside garden, it's about 300. In a non-air conditioned building, it will be 350 ppm. 1000 is the allowed amount in air condition. You can go up to 1000. At 2000, the occupants feel a little drowsy, dizzy, vomitish. And I was consultant for this insurance claim. 35 people were hospitalized. 35 guests were hospitalized. And a big bill came from a private hospital and there's an insurance claim. And they thought this was due to food poisoning. Because when this happened, they started the buffet table and all that. But when I studied the thing, I found that in five-star hotels, they have to maintain the CO2 level records. And I asked for the there was a digital the recording you can see in the computer. They had shut down the hall after the previous reception with high carbon dioxide level and kept it closed. And for following day, for the new, next function, they started with high carbon dioxide level with the fresh air intake shut and the danger of it. So having central air conditioning is also useless if the operator keeps it closed, or sometimes some people might for economy keep it closed, because if you get fresh air, you will have more and more energy to cool fresh air. So in Sri Lanka, there are no regulations, so no one inspects it. So anyone can do whatever he or she likes, and people are subjected to SBS, sick building. SBS is called sick building syndrome. The doctor who will speak later will tell. There is that drowsiness, vomitish feeling, and that bad feeling which you feel. you will realize that this happens even in cars and vans. Now, motor vehicles, air-conditioned motor vehicles started coming in 1980s, and there's on the dashboard there's a gadget to recirculate and shut. There's a gadget. But in Sri Lanka, almost 99% of the people keep it shut because they don't want dust to come in and spoil the car. Reason number two is when fascia comes in, the temperature is not maintained. Temperature rises. So because the temperature rises, they keep the fascia intake shut. So this is okay for a short, 2 or 3 miles, 5-6 miles, it's okay. But they have found that foreign countries, they have done experiments and find that a normal small car, average size car with 5 passengers, if you have it the car fully sealed, in 3 hours, the CO2 will come to 2000 ppm. That is when people will feel drowsy, dizzy, and vomiting. This is the situation when the driver falls asleep and crashes onto the fence on expressways, and a lot of accidents happen. So in motor vehicles, this very often happens. Cars, vans, and buses are also having this problem. Few months ago, my wife went on a trip to Kandy in a van, several ladies for one of their functions, and from Colombo, by the time they passed Ramukkana, they were all feeling very ill. So one lady said she wants to get out of the vehicle, so the driver stopped it and opened the door, and they found it very pleasant when they went in, because the inside of the van with about 12 ladies in a small IS van, fresh air shut, so they were breathing carbon dioxide. Actually, from on this situation, the doctor will explain that the effect comes from carbon dioxide, not oxygen depletion. Two things happen: oxygen depletes, carbon dioxide comes up. But the carbon dioxide is very toxic, not so toxic as carbon monoxide, but carbon dioxide is toxic. Doctor will speak. When the carbon dioxide reaches, 2000 ppm, you get the sick building syndrome. So you have to do it. You have to be aware of these things. Even a non-air conditioned vehicle, this danger is there. I saw about a month or two ago during the curfew, COVID curfew, Morotua campus research on a non-air conditioned AC bus. This research was done before the COVID curfew. Morotua campus had done research on a bus, CTV bus, non-air conditioned bus. So we think it is very safe because you get windows open and you get the air blast coming. They found that foul air in a turbulent state is remaining in the rear end of the bus. Fresh air comes in, goes out, but the rear end of the bus is having all the time turbulent, stagnant air in a turbulent state. This research was done by Morotua campus, and I read that article somewhere. So the different type of ACs are the split type, central type, and earlier there was a type called window type, which was very popular. There you get a fresh air intake and out. For this, you have to make a big hole on the wall, and one part of the AC is outside the wall, and the other one is inside. That type is not popular now. It's a little more expensive. The split type is cheaper, so people go in for this. The recirculation rates of air changes range from 6 to 16 times per hour. In addition to that, they have to maintain filters and hygiene of the system. So these are the things that are not done. I told you about this 5-star hotel story, and I told the filthy places, air conditioned, government-owned places, two places which I said, ID card office and the car review office. You can see similar places in hospital, waiting room, waiting halls. You get terrible. No ventilation, air condition, all sick people are there. Yeah, mind you, SBS is not that bad. If you get a man with a flu, cough, or sore throat or something, the other people get it. And now it is very dangerous because of the COVID. It's a different story. Now you can afford to get a flu and a sore throat and get absolutely cured. You would have noticed that Valisara Barrack Berisar Berak. It has gone on for three months. Why? It may not be air conditioned, but the airflow, that is the place. Naturally, air conditioning also has to have a suitable airflow. The airflow regime should be okay. And for barracks, we don't have to invent the wheel. There are designs for barracks. There are designs for hospital wards. There are designs for standard designs for operating theatres. There are separate designs for infectious disease hospitals. You can get them and download from the internet. Those are, you don't have to invent the wheel, but in Sri Lanka, nothing is done. You can see the olden days, hospitals built by the British government hospital in General Hospital. You get the wards, half wall, both sides, then two verandas on either side, fully open. Now what they make now, they are covered with windows, glass panes, and those glass panes are closed. Few are open. They are not bothered to close or open them. And infections, cross-infections, the doctor will speak on these things. I think I have initially mentioned the importance of these things, and now I think we will get the architect to speak thing. Before the architect speaks, we will I will introduce the architect, then she will put a slide, and then she will start delivering the talk. So I will introduce the architect. The architect is she is a chartered architect, also ex-army major. She started her career in the army after passing out from the SLIA. She was a captain, and then captain in the army, and she joined during the war. She preferred the army, maybe because of patriotism, I don't know. She was promoted major, but with family commitment, she had to leave the army, and she's doing private practice. But she's very concerned about this ventilation aspect, so that's why I called her to contribute on our discussion. So she will put on to slide and then start addressing.
Good evening. Thank you so much, ISL, for giving me this opportunity to share my views and knowledge about this valuable topic. Architecture is all about creating pleasant and healthy spaces. It would be great if spaces are designed. It would be great if spaces are designed allowing natural ventilation wherever possible, considering temperature, humidity, dust. We have to look into the fact whether they are tolerable or not. As an example, architect Jeffrey Bava's designs, good examples, how he has used the natural ventilation in most of his designs. When designing, we have to consider number of occupants, the activity inside, volume of space. When natural ventilation is not possible, we have to go for air conditioning system. Then we have to consult a consultant mechanical engineer, meet all the required standards, and ensure healthy environment within. Air changes rates should comply with specified international standards, depending on the purpose the space is built for. Air change rates for office, hospital, infectious wards, restaurants, reception halls, etc. will be different. In air conditioned buildings, the airflow regime inside the space should be planned. In most hotels, offices, commercial buildings, etc., all usable space and common spaces are always air conditioned. Example, in an office, if you take an office, the department head, he stays in a cubicle. Then that cubicle is within another cubicle where his staff is working. and that cubicle opens out to another cubicle, which may be the lobby space or the corridor space, and all these spaces are air conditioned with split units nowadays. So airflow regime inside the spaces should be planned. Pockets in space where air stagnates should be avoided, or if it is unavoidable, specific mechanical exhaust methods should be there. Lastly, like unless if you do not consider these facts, there will be building with attractive facades and interior, but no point, it will cause sick building syndrome. Thank you.
You have introduced I will you can see the screen.
Yes,
sir. Share. Next, the resource person will be a doctor. She will briefly explain what they would like in an air conditioning system, because ultimately when people fall ill, they have to, it becomes their burden. So now, she's a doctor, passed out in medical faculty, and she's working in a leading private hospital. She's experienced here and also worked in Australia, so she has seen high standard air conditioning practices in healthcare centers and other places. Now we will give the
Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for giving this opportunity for me to talk in this session. Now, actually, as a doctor and as any person, we all know that natural pressure is the best for any living being because it's free of pathogens. Even if there are pathogens, the pathogens always get carried away from you. But sometimes, especially in our country, there are conditions where we will have to use air conditioners because of the climate, because of the building location, congestion, and such situations, we have to use the air conditioning. But then, when we use the air conditioning in such situations, we have to be very careful to maintain an adequate airflow. We have to make sure that the air is changed within the building. So now, if we take a very common topic, recently because of the COVID-19 outbreak, the commonly believed theory was that the COVID-19 virus is very heavy, it doesn't stay in air for a long time, it falls to the ground or the surfaces very quickly. So the airborne infection is very low. That is how people believed. But now, recent studies show that this is not true, that the COVID-19 virus is very, very capable of being airborne, especially in a very dry climate. When inside the buildings also, when it's dry, it's possible for it to get airborne with a draft of air. So, and the other thing is, when this COVID-19 virus gets airborne, it is capable of living for a longer time to thrive well when the air is less humid and low in temperature. So naturally in Sri Lanka, we are lucky because our environment is high temperature and very high humidity, which is very unfavorable for the virus to grow. But when we install air conditioning, what we do is we are creating a favorable condition for this virus to grow. But as I told you, sometimes it's necessary to install the air conditioners because of the conditions. So in such situations, that is why we have to maintain the proper air circulation. And then the other thing is, despite all these air changes, even in an air conditioned building, as Mr. Nissanka Sayarasimha explained you, in a central air conditioning system, there is air changes, but still there can be air pockets and crevices where the air will stay stagnated and it is not exchanged properly. So the viruses, pathogens can grow in those air spaces. So the best thing now, there are modern developments for these air conditioning systems where they study to remove the pathogens by UV radiation, plasma, and such developments, modern developments. So we have to be in touch with all these modern developments. And as Mr. Nissanka Sayarasimha explained earlier, sick building syndrome, that is a very important thing because as he explained, in some buildings, there is the air conditioning, but not enough air coming from outside. So for example, if we take a room where a split air condition is, there is no or very, very little amount of air coming from outside. And there may be more than the usual amount of people inside that building. Maybe a party is going on or some occasion and there is a lot of people inside there, but no ventilation, the carbon dioxide level goes up and causes the sick building syndrome, because when the carbon dioxide level goes up, it affects your brain. The people feel drowsy, and ultimately when the carbon dioxide level goes very high, they get unconscious. So that is what happens. So we have to be in touch with all the modern developments to maintain proper air circulation in a building where the air conditioning is necessary. So as in our olden days, the buildings, we didn't have air conditioning in our country at all, but there was adequate space to maintain proper air circulation because the buildings were opened, they were spacious. But nowadays, especially in city areas, that's not practical. So we have to make buildings, high-rise buildings, which are enclosed, which needs air conditioning. So what we have to do is to maintain proper air circulation in this area. Thank you. I will hand over to Mr. Nissanka.
I'll explain now. Okay, slide again. I think the architect and the doctor gave more enlightened view on the from their side. Now, just complaining, waiting without any action, but complaining only won't work. As engineers, I myself. will also have to take the initiative. Now, see the army engineer, Indian army engineers, inform their Indian COVID task force. Those documents are there. You can see the, even that document is signed. You can go into the internet and see. They, you don't have to do espionage to get the army information. They have published, made it public because it's a good thing. Now, as for our country, fortunately, COVID didn't attack Sri Lanka, the people, the society. COVID was mainly, COVID mainly attacked the Vellisera Navy camp and the foreign tourists, foreign people who, or the people who came from abroad. Otherwise, in Sri Lanka, there was no clusters developing internally. Thanks to our timely action by our president, we must thank him every day for what he did. If he didn't take that action of if they didn't take that action of closing down the spaces and curfew and all that, we would have developed a lot of pockets, and we would have also had hundreds of thousands of people. Hundreds of thousands of people suffering with this. Now, what as regards the Sri Lankan COVID task force is concerned, when I saw this Indian Army document, I emailed it to the task force. There's a lady engineer in the task force. Maybe IESL member, you'll be knowing. I don't know her, but I emailed it. The email went. It didn't get rejected or. But nothing happened. Maybe the COVID problem in Sri Lanka is not so grave that air conditioning should not be looked into. But I don't think that should be done. You have to do everything perfect. Now you get public health inspectors who check tens of boutiques and restaurants. They come and check your garden to see whether there are dengue mosquitoes. Why can't they check with the, they can be educated and empowered to check the air conditioning standards. And anyone who does a function should be certified. Now, you know that electrician can't do house wiring unless he gets certified. The plumber with a plumber's license is the correct way. Maybe that things are not happening that way. A building has to be approved, the structure has to be approved by a structural engineer, the building, the spaces, architectural design by a standard architect. Should be done, but air conditioning anyone can do. Air conditioning vendors go and fix anything what they like. They are not air conditioning engineers. If they call them engineers, I am very sorry about it. Air conditioning is fixed in organized in places by vendors, and they compete. So to compete, what they do is they tell the client to close all the doors and windows, and they put a lower wattage unit, and then the cooling is there. Or people have it. They believe that air conditioning is only cooling. So there should be government authorities looking at these things, because air conditioning started in 1980s and now every other place is air conditioned. Air conditioning started in Sri Lanka in 1960s. First place was Liberty Cinema. The first car was D.S. Naikar's car, and then Bansri one Cadillac, Sir John Pothalavala's Cadillac. Now every car is air conditioned. So now we can't have those. Those days there were no rules, but today we had to introduce regulations to see that air conditioning is done properly. Like house wiring is done, like plumbing is done, like how a building is done. Building can't be put up without a chartered architect's signature. So for air conditioning also, they should be done. So the IESL is the body to tell the government, because they would know these things unless we point out. Now the behavior of the Indian army engineers and the Indian ISRAE, that is ISRAE is Indian Society for Heating, Refrigeration and Air Conditioning Engineers. They are informing COVID STF. It should be commended. Now, if some places are air conditioned in a poor manner, I wouldn't say that this should be all demolished and discarded, but you can augment them and retrofit things and make it come within specifications. In fact, I saw a very interesting thing. This is a very humorous thing. I went to meet a chief engineer of an air conditioner vendor. I called him vendor because they sell air conditioner, but they were chief engineer. This was about maybe 10 years ago. I walked into his room and his room was in a air-conditioned space, in an air-conditioned space, in another air-conditioned space, like what the architect explained to you. You know, the fresh air has to go through one air-conditioned space to the other space, and then reach this engineer was living in such a small room. And immediately when I sat there, I saw an opening on the wall. So I asked him, "You are getting fresh air separately?" "Yeah, because he's an engineer, he knows it. So for his safety, he has put a fresh air supply." So this is the situation. People are unnecessarily falling ill. Maybe if you have good air conditioning systems, the people who get, our doctor will know respiratory diseases and all that will be less, even if COVID is eradicated. Our president will eradicate COVID at that time. We're sure about it. But we shouldn't be complacent. We should have high standards of air conditioning like any other thing. I think now any questions could be asked if there are any.
Yes, now we are moving to the Q&A section.
Yeah.
I can see some questions have been asked in group chat section. So I would like to hand over controls to Engineer Ganesh Dahanayake to moderate the Q&A session. Engineer Ganesh, you are there, right?
Thank you, Engineer Randhika. It was a very informative and timely needed presentation. Thank you again for during this presentation, Engineer Nishankar, and Architect Ashika, and Dr. Chandramali. And there are a lot of questions, I think, with the audience. To start the question and answer session, I would first refer to Engineer Nishankar Seerasinghe. Normally, if you consider about 10 years ago or 15 years ago, air conditioners were a luxurious item, but now it's becoming more commodity, the essential commodity. Now we see a lot of air conditioners being installed. How to check whether this air conditioned space is healthy or not? I mean, is there any method to check the health level or the whether it's working? I mean, the functional workingness we can see, but whether it's suitable for the persons inside, how to check that?
Yeah, that's a very, very good question. Actually, I should have told you this during my presentation. Now you know that in a place, in a space, if there are a lot of people, the carbon dioxide level goes up and oxygen level comes down. And there are other things also happening. Like, for example, if someone is frying sausages or something in a barbecue, then that smell also will come. But I am not referring to those things. But the most 99% of the places, the bad effect is due to a lot of people there. And they are sending out carbon dioxide and consuming oxygen. Now, it is very easy to monitor the CO2 level. Now, actually, I thought of buying one for no other reason. I checked on the internet. You all can check in the internet. Handheld CO2 meters. Now, I told you that in the outside garden, it is 300 ppm. In an air-conditioned building, up to 1,000 ppm is allowed. And 2,000 ppm, you get the building syndrome things. Now, this CO2 meter is calculated to read this. So, if you are going to a bank to cash money or deposit money or something, when you go in, you can carry that. And if it is over 1,000, better stop going to that bank. This CO2 meter is the best and the cheapest and the easiest way of finding out the air quality. Of course, air quality due to other poisonous like some arsenic, sulfur dioxide, or some poisonous gas, it will be more complicated. But 95% of the things where it is CO2 that is causing the problem. But if others will have to have a specific testing instrument to check whether there is methane or some other gas. But CO2 meter is very cheap. In the internet, you can get it down through eBay or Alibaba, those trading organizations. I checked 15,000, 20,000 rupees handled meter. Have I answered the question?
Thank you very much, Engineer Sarasinghe. Now, there's a question asked from Kevin Patirage. Mr. Kevin Patirage. ASHRAE standards governing the world, but at same time Indian standards are the ASHRAE. But what is the actually, do we have a standard in Sri Lanka?
So, Sri Lankan, I know that there are ASHRAE qualified engineers in Sri Lanka. That I know, but I have not met any Indian ASHRAE qualified engineers in Sri Lanka. But ASHRAE is based on ASHRAE. ASHRAE started long years ago, but I think for us ASHRAE will be better because ASHRAE conditions are similar to Sri Lanka but not identical. Now remember, India has a hot dry climate. Now Dr. Chandramali mentioned that fortunately we are having a hot wet climate. That's why we are not having COVID, thanks to President. That's one reason. The other one is we are having a humid hot climate which the COVID virus hates. How often we have to get fresh air if there is no AC but closed windows most of the time feels like Noralia. Yeah, now it feels like Noralia. You don't have to air condition, but they close the doors. Still, there is air coming in and out through infiltration, but some places it can get dangerous. But in the bigger, richer people's houses, you get fireplaces. Now, if for the heat, what they do is they light the fire. I have been to some planters' houses and I have seen that happening. They have servants, they light a fire. So the fire draws in air from outside, burns and it goes out to the chimney, so there's a natural ventilation that's called airflow regime. But you have to have a certain amount of infiltration. It's called infiltration. That is through crevices and other places. It has to come into the building. If you have it totally sealed and if you stay, the same thing. It's like, you know, packing people in a container, the human smuggling to Europe, Afghanistan, people going, they are taken in containers. Like that. So, still you have to have fresh air if you have it closed, totally closed. But the poor people's houses are not sealed. I have seen them. When I was a trainee engineer, I spent nearly 1 year in Noralia, installing the brew house in the brewery in Noralia. I was a very young engineer and I lived there for a long time. And I have seen poor people's houses and rich people's houses. Poor people's houses, they are not airtight because of their poverty. Rich people's houses, there is a tendency for it to be airtight, but they have still the fireplaces and the chimneys are there. But the fresh air comes in through infiltration.
Thank you, Engineer Sarasinghe. Next, I will move into Architect Ashika. There's a question asked about now the architects are the complaint against the building designs. It could be nice looking buildings. At the same time, with the design, it may make into a place that a lot of energy has to be used to artificially ventilated or air conditioned. So, but we know that city area, it is very difficult to keep buildings nice and comfortable. So you will have to use air condition. What are the designs that you frequently adapted in the city buildings and as well as the other rural buildings to get the natural ventilation?
Yeah, it's like that. Now, the main working space, because nowadays we use mostly the computers, so we need to have this air conditioning spaces. But when we go out from that, we shouldn't go to another air conditioned space, maybe the common lobby space or the corridor space. So what I adapt is, I do the common areas, it's naturally ventilated. You get more, it's a natural ventilation lobby space, or the walking passage or the staircase. But in some cases, some clients, like they have, it's very hard to convince clients in Sri Lanka. Sometimes they say, no, we'll just close it down, and like we want it, we don't want people peeping in or something like that. So in nowadays, it's a very big challenge and to find a good understanding clients actually. And and I think the fixing, the most in most offices, you have fixed glasses. And you can't, like in the evening also, you can't open up once there. If you have openable windows, so in my spaces, I ensure that there are some open windows where you can open up. So so evening or afternoon lunch session, PNO, somebody, people who are working, they can like just open it and get some fresh air. So we have to keep some provision. And without having like all the time, we have to have these spaces like open without having like asaval enna thu enna, like arahema, like that's very bad. So you have to create your spaces like a very clear open environment, so then it's easy for the air conditioning engineer also to handle that areas very efficiently.
Thank you, Ashika. And other thing is that when you select the building material, because now the the fittings and the infiltration of the heat
is, yes,
but
there are nowadays
what do you recommend?
Cladding boards and stuff, they go for aesthetic, but that is absolutely can't recommend, because I hate cladding. But there are good buildings, you can see in India also, they use this natural tile, terracotta tiles and stuff to in the beautify your building exterior. So it should be something like very natural things you have to use mainly, because I mentioned Jeffrey Bawa, because the way he has done hotels, offices, the Mahamali building and everything. So you can stay without all the natural, with the natural materials and the natural way of ventilation and lighting and ventilation. So I don't think it's a big challenge to do it. It's mainly we have to somehow convince the clients, and also public should be also aware of this without going to these unnatural products which is exported from other countries. We have local products. With the local products, we can beautify our buildings.
Right, thank you. It's very convincing actually. And next, I will
questions.
There's some other questions.
When we used AC, external surface of the room getting wet, not only that, it becomes below slab soft or something. When we use AC is, when we use AC, external surface of the room getting wet, not only that, it becomes below slab soft.
This is asking about the condensation, I think.
Condensation should be looked after in the air conditioning system, because condensed liquid should not be allowed to drop into a wall or the soil or anywhere. It should be ducted carefully and send it to a safe place.
If I ask the same question again, I mean, they asked about AC external surface. I mean, if the building, the interior inside is cold and the other, which is exposed to the outside, is again the surface is maybe cold and you can see the condensation from the outside.
That is, in that case, your building is not insulated. You are even losing energy. You are having, you are getting the coolness to get out. You know, you are not having an insulated wall. If you have a, say, Takaran wall, what you say can happen immediately. Because your inside temperature, the inside the wall and the outside will be, say, if it is 20 degrees, outside also will be at about 22 degrees. Then there will be condensation outside. But if you have a very insulated wall, you will have no heat, no cooling effect on the outside. Insulation is the answer for that.
Thank you. And next, I will move to Dr. Chandramali's voice. And now, during these days, so about a lot of things are talked about WHO, WHO guidelines. SARS, the SARS disease and everything. Now we see some WHO guidelines, but with the COVID and other diseases, I mean airborne diseases, we don't see much guidelines, any guidelines given. So, what are the things? What are the guidelines? What are the recommendations you practice at the hospitals or within the health sector?
Actually, the thing is, this COVID-19 is a new pathogen. They have recently encountered it and now they are studying it. So they didn't get the chance to study it for years and years yet. Now is the time they are studying it and developing new ideas about it and all. That is why the idea, as I told earlier also, that is why the idea is changing now. That earlier they said it's not airborne, but now the idea is changing that it is getting airborne. So actually in hospitals, for example, I'm working in a leading private hospital. The hospital setup should be, it's always, it's a big building. So it's always central AC. It's always central AC, and the central AC should be effectively running, and always there should be adequate air changes. So as Mr. Nishanka says in her explained earlier also, better if we can have frequent checkups in the inside the building and check whether the carbon dioxide level is maintained properly, because if the carbon dioxide level is maintained, that means there is proper air changes. So even sometimes when we work in the hospital, the rooms are also central air conditioned, but when we go into the rooms, sometimes we find the patients have switched off the ACs. There are too many people inside, so that should be totally banned. That shouldn't be allowed in a building. And regarding the studies about the COVID-19 virus, as I said, they are studying it. Now, if you want to know how it get airborne, how it changed, how this theory of getting airborne changed, when a person coughs or sneezes, what happens is the virus is expelled together with the droplets. So maybe it's sticky with saliva, it's expelled, and it tends to fall down. It tends to fall down in the air and then gets deposited on surfaces, ground anywhere. But when it dries up, like dust with a gush of air, it can get airborne again. And if the temperature is cool, and if the humidity is low, these viruses which fall to the ground or the surfaces will stay alive. So when they stay alive, and when air comes and they get airborne again, they are capable of infecting other people. That's how the new theory works. So still the studies are being done. So we have to keep in touch to see how the theories change and what new theories they find. Yes. Am I clear or is there any more questions? Yes, Mr. Nisanka says.
I did some reading on this about the COVID-19. They have not laid out any guidelines so far in WHO. But for COVID-19 is because they found the virus in 2019. That's how the 19 comes. Then there's another thing called COVID-16, which came in 1916. Then there's COVID-6 or something. I can't remember. There are the number denotes the year which that virus was found. Now for the earlier COVIDs and SARS and Ebola, all those guidelines are there now. But for COVID-19, they have not still formulated it. I kept on searching to see whether WHO has not done. There are other organizations in China, Europe, and other countries where they have formulated the guidelines for COVID-19, but not WHO. Any other questions? Energy balance.
This ratios.
No,
is there any standard in
zero? No, energy efficiency ratios, maybe this energy consumption rates and all that, maybe the air conditioning engineers, the ASHRAE qualified Sri Lankan engineers who have passed ASHRAE exams, they will know to calculate all those things accurately, the ratios. It's very common sense that if you have a lot of air changes, you will have need more energy. So to save on energy, they close down, seal it, and have no air changes. They have seal place, and that is what the vendors do. Vendors, because there's breakneck competition to outbid the other. If someone recognized or a professional air conditioning man gives a quotation, it will be high because he will give a professional offer with adequate air changes. But a crookish vendor will offer a very cheap one and seal all the places. Energy efficiency ratios. I told outside the insulation was. Ventilators, humidifiers, etc. Now, humidifiers are used for a different purpose. That is, humidifiers are not generally used in Sri Lanka, but sometimes there are some people, you get these units when the water is made to evaporate, it has a cooling effect. So that drops the temperature, but increases the humidity in the space. So those are not very popular. They are not, at once the problem. There's a slight drop in temperature, but the humidity increases. And the people feel comfort when your perspiration dries. That is, when there's perspiration and if there's a fan blowing air, your skin cools. But in air conditioning practice, if there are any ASHRAE qualified engineers in your institute, in IESL, they will know that in a 5-star hotel, you can't have drafts, you can't feel drafts because the international hotels trade, they send inspectors and they walk through the hotel and if they feel drafts, they knock down the 5-star to 4-star. You can't, air conditioning is a thing, it has to be cool, not blowing air. But in our Sri Lanka, people sit in front of the air conditioner or in your car, you turn the vents towards you. That is wrong air conditioning, drafts. This is very bad because when you have a draft coming, it can throw the viruses and bacteria also. And worst thing is in central air conditioning, return air duct. Now, once I was asked to sit near a return air duct, yeah, fresh, cold air is supplied in to the hotel. I won't mention the name. Then the foul air is sucked out from a place and taken back to the AC room. So now, when I sat there, I found a draft coming towards me. It was foul air coming and going through the return air duct because I changed my seat. So these are very dangerous. They are very, that is, there is a very poor airflow regime in such a place. They should not put seats for the guests.
Now we can give a chance to our audience. If you have any question, you can raise your hand. There's a button saying that.
One more on the printed thing, I have not answered. What is the minimum percentage of natural air recommended for an air conditioned space? Minimum air. Minimum air in the tabulations, they specify, I think, 4 to 16. If you check, they say for a school classroom, for a computer room, for a healthcare center, that is for a dispensary, get various specifications. In the internet, you can go and find out. There are ranging from, I think, 6 to 16. As I told you, for the autopsy place, of course, no air changes. You have to have the air complete air change, so removed and new air put in, if you're having it in a room. Otherwise, you have to do the autopsy in the garden. Now, presently, the American president meets the people and all that in the lawn, White House, the White House lawn. He doesn't have it in the room because they are the air change is unlimited. So, natural thing is the best.
Now, with this COVID-related problems, epidemic actually, in air conditioning systems, we know that there are filters. But yes. we have seen that in vehicles, you change your air filter. But we haven't seen a change in filters in air conditioning systems very much.
So, I have of course seen the filter change in that, depends on the client. Now, some people don't have the filters at all. They have thrown the filters away in some houses. In some places, the filter is there and they change the filter. And the filter, I have read somewhere in the internet, because of this talk, I did a lot of research on the internet. The filter changes also should be made more frequent if the manufacturer has recommended 1,000 hours. Now you do it for 500 hours or whatever. Yeah, I am not sure of the figure, but what I say is even the filter changes have to be made fast. And also remember that filters also places where they trap the viruses. You get crevices inside the filter casings, evaporator casings. You get static places where the air flows, but leaving those crevices uncleared. So you have to be careful. A servicing man should clean all those things with water when he comes to service. There is central air conditioning and even split units. Split units also you get inside the filters.
Now we will give the chance to the audience to directly ask a question.
There's one more question, printed question.
At the same time, you can answer this printed question.
Yes. Last one. There are standalone air conditioned units designed to filter air in the room against pathogens. Are these effective? Yeah, actually, I have no idea about this, but we'll get the doctor to say there are air circulation units. That is, they are not air conditioners. You keep on circulating air, and then you apply your ultraviolet or plasma or whatever and kill the germs. Have you got such systems in the hospital? Or have you seen it abroad?
No,
we have no experience. Doctors.
I haven't seen such situations in our country yet. Those are the new development things to remove the pathogens by UV radiation
continuous circulation,
you kill the pathogens while they are flowing through. You apply UV radiation, plasma radiation, and destroy these pathogens. But these are all new developments, still under research. Not I haven't seen it yet in Sri Lanka.
We handing over the control back to engineer Radhika Amarasurya. Engineer Radhika, please unmute your mic.
Right. Thank you very much, Ganesh, for conducting that Q&A session. We have come to the end of a very informative and timely important session. Now it's time to pay our gratitude. So I would like to invite engineer Arjun Manamperi to conduct the vote of thanks. Engineer Manamperi is our former chair of Mechanical Engineering Sectional Committee from 2014 to 2017, and he was the chairman of CPD committee of ISL from 2017 to 2019. So without further ado, I invite Engineer Manamperi to conduct the to deliver the vote of thanks.
Short. Thank you very much, Dr. Chandramali Munavira, Architect Major, Retired Major Ashika Munasinghe, and Mr. Sarasinghe for your valuable time and making a very pleasant, the Zoom lectures are not always tolerable, but you made it very natural and very tolerable. I like the attire of all of you, very pleasant. Those are important things actually in Zoom lectures. And the natural flair. In fact, Mr. Sarasinghe, you were doing the right thing by not using so many slides, but speaking to the audience. That's what they say to do. So you are a natural. If you want to pursue this as a professional gig, you are a natural presenter on Zoom. With that statement, I would like to thank the audience. There were quite a few people, actually, more than the normal whom they would come to the ISL, double that amount number. And I think they were very patient and very careful listening to everything you had to say. It may not have been a technical session, but what's important is that the practical part of it. With that, I thank Randhika as well, Engineer Randhika, and the Mechanical Engineering Sectional Committee and the ISL staff who may have set up the Zoom links and everything else and the advertisements. So thank you very much all. Have a pleasant week. Make sure that your air conditions have enough airflow coming through, natural airflow. Don't live in a closed room with the AC on. That's what I learned today. Thank you very much. Good night. Have a good day.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Engineer Manamperi, for that vote of thanks. And with that, I conclude the session. Wishing all of you a very good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.